Gentlemen, today we're going to be talking about three lessons I learned from my father here on Big Pretty Man. Hi, and welcome back to Big Pretty Man, the channel for the extra-large man who wants to live his life large and in charge. I'm your host, Timothy Big Pretty Crow. I'm a wardrobe and lifestyle consultant for the extra-large man. You know, gentlemen, and yes, I am speaking to the gentlemen, to the men out there. We, as men, we stand on the shoulders of our fathers and on the shoulders of our grandfathers and our great-grandfathers and then the patrilineal line that runs all the way back to the beginning of time. Now, of course, our mothers gave great contributions to who we are. However, in our Western culture, at least, it is the patrilineal line that we give the most emphasis, especially as men. It is the male surname of our fathers that we pass on to our sons, you know, and whereas, you know, when we give to our daughters, but our daughters will take the names of their husbands and their children will take the names of their father. So for a man, the father figure is the example that we follow to let us know what being a man and what masculinity is about. Now, this can, you know, whether this be from your biological father, adoptive father, stepfather, or even your grandfather, or even your uncles, you know, it is these men that came before us that teach us how to be men and are the examples of how a man should be. Or sometimes they're an anti or reverse example of how a man should not be. I think we've all got a few of those too. My own father was a little bit of both. Now I will say that my own relationship with my father was was one that could be very tumultuous. The biggest reason is because we were just too much alike. I'm a lot like my father. I even look like my father. But, we were both headstrong, highly opinionated, highly charismatic, highly temperamental, and neither one of us was the type to back down. We'd rather die than back down. And that calls for a very explosive relationship at times. You know, you have two men that are just damn determined not to back down no matter what. It ended up being, a lot of times in our family, a game of chicken by which neither one was going to swerve. And yes, there was quite a bit of demolition and damage over the years. However, I did love my father. I did learn some things from him. Now, my father actually passed away in 2001 at just the age of 58. He had been due to industrial exposure when he was in his 20s. He had worked for a metal processing plant in his 20s that did not have proper safety guidelines, did not have proper ventilation or proper gear like masks. And he ended up breathing, this place was full of metal dust, and he ended up breathing in all of this metal dust. Well, that metal dust was like little microscopic razor blades that embedded into his lungs. But over the decades, by the time he hit his 50s, they had, you know, all those little razor blades of steel had cut thousands of small holes throughout his lungs to the point that it was irreparable. So, you know, and he did end up dying at the age of 58 due to respiratory edema that led to cardiac arrest. So I lost him far too young. One of my maternal uncles had started working at that same plant a year before my father and actually helped him get the job. And he ended up in later decades and later life with the exact same condition. He died almost exactly a year before my father did. So apparently both these men had the same time period of exposure to cause their deaths. So now I am now 52 years old. So I am within the life decade as well as the stage of life that my father was in when he passed away. And in fact, I'm close to, I'm just 6 years from catching up with him. So, I have him on my mind quite a bit, because my own experiences as a man are starting to approach the level of maturity that his were. And it makes me reflect back on him quite a bit. Now, a little bit about my father. My father was had been a soldier. He spent time in the military, and then he became a master welder. He worked for a Ford Motor Company for over a decade, and also for Hyster Forklift Company, welding on forklifts. And up until his 50s, when he became ill from this old exposure I just mentioned, and had to retire. He was also a very talented mechanic. He actually ran his own mechanic shop for a while, he would buy motorcycles that people, had bought for their kids that they didn't ride anymore. Something went wrong and they would just toss it. My dad would buy it. It was like, it just needs a new spark plug. Clean it up and sell it for quite a bit of profit. He actually ran a fairly successful mom-pop little grassroots business out there that kept him going up until he died. At the same time, he did teach me a few lessons, even in our tumultuous relationship, and that have stuck with me. And I thought I would share the three best that have served me through life with you today, and make you maybe think about what were the top three lessons that your father taught you, or whatever dominant male in your life taught you. Now, the first lesson that my father taught me is actually a very simple one, but I've found that some of the greatest wisdom are in the simplest of things. And it was simply this: you do not have the job, no matter what they say, until you sign those W-2s. And that is so true. It seems like it's kind of a don't count your chickens before they hatch thing. But in this particular situation, it really does apply. I think a lot of us have been through the experience of going through an interview or a series of interviews at some company, and being told, hey, yeah, you're a perfect man for the job. I like you. I think you're pretty much guaranteed. Yeah, we're going to bring you on. Congratulations and all that, and get you all worked up. And then all of a sudden, you think, oh, hey, I got it. I got this job. You start telling even your friends, your family, want to celebrate a little bit. And then all of a sudden, you don't have the job. somebody in the company decided to step up, use their seniority as clout to step up in the company. Some relative of the supervisor or the manager or who or whatever, needed the job, and they got him in. There's a lot of different reasons why suddenly you don't have the job, but it is a common it's a common occurrence. And my dad's absolutely right. Until you put your names on those W-2 forms, until you put your names on those tax forms, you don't have, and sign them at the bottom, you don't have that job. And it is, after having that happen once or twice, I really learned that lesson. No matter what they say, no matter what bullshit spiel that they're giving you, all the praises and accolades, until you sign those tax papers, you don't have that job. So Dad was right. Now, the second lesson that my father taught me was probably the most profound and wise thing I ever heard him say. And it was this: a marriage or relationship is part love and part habit. The love can die, but the habit will kill you. And if anybody out there, and probably about half the men out there that are listening to this at least, have been through a divorce, or most of us have been through the end of a relationship. And if you think about it, this is so, so true. And actually has been one of the most helpful things that he ever said in my own life. I've been through two divorces and a couple of ended relationships. So, and those words actually helped me get through it, because they are so true. Now, I think we've all been in a relationship where the love just died. It can do it for several reasons. It can do it, just simply two people that will start growing apart. As you mature, you just start going in different directions till you start to lack having compatibility and you start moving in different directions. And eventually the connection between you starts to weaken, and finally is just gone. Even the emotional, you know, the emotional attachment to them is now gone. So, and, you know, like I said, it can be caused sometimes by economy. It can be caused by infidelity or adultery. It can, you know, it can be called, you know, it can be caused by disagreement over children, the raising of children. There's a lot of different elements. But usually, even like with the adultery, infidelity, if you look under the surface at the base of what's going on, it usually is a couple that have been growing apart and just not wanting to admit it. They're no longer invested in the relationship as they were. The love is just not there, and the love is either dying or completely dead. And it's just time to move on. Louis C.K. made the joke in one of his specials that whenever you hear somebody say, "Yeah, I just got divorced," don't be like, "Oh, I'm so sorry," because it's never bad news when someone gets a divorce. Because by the time you sign those papers, it's usually the love is gone. There are some tragic situations where that doesn't happen, but usually, probably 95% of the time, the divorce is something that's welcomed. However, even despite that, and even knowing that deep down, you know, you end up going through the depression, the loneliness, the loss of stability, the heartache. And a lot of times I think we mistake that heartache for love or loss of love. But actually, the love has probably been gone maybe for years in that relationship. And it just became, you know. But what's your action? When you really sit and think about what is making you depressed and what has just tore your world down, it's not because of the loss of the love. It's because of the loss of the habit of being with a person. And everybody knows what I'm talking about that's been a relationship, especially a long-term relationship. You get into a certain routine. You get used to, you know, a certain pattern of living. You get used to the home. You get used to your side of the bed. You get used to the schedule that you have set up with this person. You know, you get used to the habit of living with that person. Now, all of a sudden, especially for men, because usually we're the ones that leave the house. All of a sudden, you know, you've had the floor jerked out from under you. You know, now your stability is gone. Your routine is completely gone. You have to come up with a new one. You don't even know where to start. Yeah, you know, she's got even got the bed. You've got to get another bed to break in. You know, a new apartment, a new schedule, a new routine, a new life. And that can be very overwhelming and can bring on quite a bit of depression. And it's, like I said, I think it's very easy to mistake the loss of this habit as a loss of love. You're not in love with that person. You are missing and we're in love with the habit, with the schedule, with the routine, with the house. That's what, or even loss of your, you know, being around your children every day. Because usually women, you know, the children end up with the mother, and men get visitation rights. And that one is a real heartbreak. But you're not really grieving her. You're grieving the loss of the situation and the familiarity. And when I've went through my breakups and I went through my two divorces, I always remember that. You know, just ask yourself, if you go through that or if you are going through that, really ask yourself, am I missing the love of her, or am I missing the life and the home and the routine and the habit that we set up together? Once you realize, if you come to realize, I'm not in love with her, I don't miss her, I miss the life I had, then it makes it easier to build a new life and a new habit and a new routine. And once you do that, it will really help you get through that divorce or that breakup. So, and my father was horrible with relationships, so he really knew. He really put some thought into this. He had been married 3 times. All those marriages ended, in divorce, and several relationships where he didn't marry that ended in separation, and usually a hard separation. In truth, most of them, I'll even say, were his fault. He loved to argue. He loved, you know, to him it was like a debate to try to win. That never works in a relationship. He was also, though he would have bucked if I'd said it, in fact, I think I did say it, he was a bit insecure. You know, he always expected women to fawn around on him. It was just obvious they weren't. You know, but he was insecure in relationships. And in fact, oh God, when he was grieving out of a relationship, I know, because I'd pull up to his house and I would hear that big floor model stereo, you know, those big wood floor model stereos, the, you know, had the 8-track in it as well as the record player, multiple record player inside and the radio. I knew if I pulled up and I heard, my father was a big George Jones fan, and if I walked up and I heard that twangy, He Stopped Loving Her Today, or my favorite, If Drinking Don't Kill Me, Her Memory Will, or the Grand Tour. God, I knew he was drunk and he was grieving out at the end of a relationship. And I knew walking in that door what I was going to be dealing with. So he had plenty of practice in contemplation, you know, in his cups and in his George Jones music to figure this out. So once again, you know, this was wisdom from some very negative experience. Now, the third lesson that my father taught me was not as profound, but it was as equally wise and useful. And it was, never pee on electric fence. And unfortunately, let me tell you, I accidentally did that, so I very much know the results of that, of breaking that rule. Wow. Wow. You know, I lived on a farm where we had the electric fence for the cattle. I remember once I stopped, it was on a country road, nobody out there, I stopped to pee, and I didn't realize into a creek, standing on top of a culvert, you know, a water tunnel. I didn't realize that my grandfather had put the electric fence at the bottom, so it hit it, and bam, my hair stood up in all kinds of places, burned me up. You know, I saw on Mythbusters that they supposedly busted this myth that you could get electrocuted or get a major shock from peeing on a railroad live wire. They say that urine comes out in single drops, not in one steady stroll. Bullshit. I'm living proof that I must have a much more straighter stream, because, man, that electric run right through my old dad and burned me up. So it definitely good, maybe a little direct and uncouth, but damn good advice. Now, in conclusion, I'd like to just mention a few lessons of anti behavior that I learned from my father, and there's a lot, but I'll just name one that applies really to this channel, and that is that my father was the direct opposite in me when it comes to being a sophisticated, well-dressed gentleman. That just wasn't my dad at all. You know, my dad, all of his life, he had oil and grease in his hands, to the point that they had embedded into the calluses. So he could wash and scrub all day. That wasn't coming out. Also, toward the end of his life, he got really, you know, he never was a big dresser, which always disturbed my mother, who was. You know, my dad was blue jeans and t-shirt, usually with a hole in the t-shirt, you know, which drove my mother nuts. He just saw any type of dressing up like that. It was just unneeded and putting on airs that you didn't need. In fact, my father, in his personality, in his commentary, and in his dress, was a lot like Fred Sanford, for all those that remember Sanford and Son. In fact, it was one of his favorite shows. In fact, he loved to tell me, "I brought you in the world, I'll take you out," with the fist up. That was one of my dad's favorite lines. He said it a lot. The man has been dead almost 21 years, and I don't think that he could I doubt that he smells any worse now than he did when he was alive. His hygiene was just, especially in the end of his life, was just terrible. My dad always had a certain cologne, a certain fragrance of a combination of Camel cigarettes, motor oil, and ass. That was dad. You know, very dear, you know, and I turned out just the opposite. I think maybe because of my mother's influence, but even more than that, and here's where another male came in my life, was my maternal grandfather, a very strong, powerful man, real authoritarian type of man. He come from Scotch heritage, stood straight as an arrow to the day he died, had a vitality that was just unreal, fathered 10 children. Even in his late 80s, near his 90s, he would walk into a building up steps and never touch the rail, and straight as an arrow. And he was a very dapper dresser. You know, I never saw my grandfather that he did not have on at least dress pants and a dress shirt, and always that trilby hat. And really, I think that, and I really looked up to him, as did the rest of my family. He was the center of our universe. And, you know, we all just practically worshipped him. And I was the same. And I think that's one thing that definitely rubbed off on me. So even our, you know, on our maternal sides, our grandfathers can have such a great influence upon us. Well, okay, gentlemen, I know this is a bit of a short video, especially for me, but, you know, I hope that you enjoyed it, and I hope it makes you think about your father, whether they're living or dead. And for those that have a living father or living grandfather, definitely take those times to get that wisdom, to learn those lessons, to make that connection, because we only get one life, and we only get the people in our life for a certain amount of time, and when they're gone, they're lost. And, you know, and everything, all the wisdom, if you don't get it, all those gems of wisdom goes with them. So definitely, definitely pick up pick up that wisdom and pass it on to your sons, so they can pass it on to their sons, and, you know, and all the way up through the unknown, undiscovered country of the future. Okay. Well, you know, and also while you're at it, don't forget to please, if you haven't already, to subscribe. To Big Pretty Man. Join the Big Pretty Nation, you know, and hit this little King Henry head with my pretty face. And also, as you may have noticed in my last two videos, I uploaded, transferred and uploaded two videos from my other channel, Lessons from the Purple Chair, where I talk about a curio of different topics. And I've seen that a lot of people seem to be enjoying those. Well, jump over there to Lessons from the Purple Chair and give me a subscription there. I want to get that one really going. I'm having a lot of fun with it. Okay, so, you know, honor your fathers, honor the men in your lives, partake of that wisdom, and while you do it, you stay pretty.